Welcome to our webinar, an up-close look at biocatalysis, accelerating syntheses using nature's catalysts. My name is Charlotte and I'm here with Mark Muldowney and Greg Holgate. Mark and Greg, will you like to introduce yourselves, please?
Hi, I'm Mark Muldowney. I'm Head of Innovation at Sterling Pharma Solutions and I'm joined today by my colleague Greg Holgate.
Thank you, Mark. So my name's Greg Holgate. I'm a research chemist working here at Stirling in collaboration with Northumbria University. And currently I'm undertaking a 24-month EPSRC and Innovate UK funded knowledge transfer partnership, or KTP. I've been working on this now for approximately 18 months.
Thank you, Mark and Greg. Today we are going to discuss biocatalysis, area that has experienced tremendous growth in the pharmaceutical industry in recent years. Today we'll be starting off by providing a general overview of biocatalysis, analysing its growth and highlighting its key benefits. Next we'll be discussing the immobilisation of enzymes and its advantages for the pharmaceutical industry. We'll then shift the discussion to Stirling and our approach to biocatalysis. Finally, we will end with a case study to provide a greater insight into Stirling's biocatalysis solutions. With that, I'd like to turn over to Greg.
Thanks, Charlotte. So let's begin by discussing exactly what biocatalysis is and what's driven its growth. So since the 1970s, biocatalysis, or the use of enzymes to speed up chemical reactions, has gained significant traction in a wide variety of industries, including that of pharmaceutical development and manufacturing. Major technological advances have enabled more efficient enzyme discovery and manufacture, and this has led to an unprecedented growth in the demand for such technology, with the global market for biocatalysis anticipated to grow by approximately 15% between 2019 and 2024. So within today's webinar, we'd like to discuss some of the key concepts behind the use of enzymes as catalysts, why we think it's so advantageous, and how our approach to biocatalysis at Stirling delivers superior solutions to our customers. So, to begin, it's worth taking a look at the history of biocatalysis, I guess as we know it today. So, records show that ambient yeasts were used in brewing and fermentation processes around 8,000 years ago. However, I guess in these times there was little regard placed upon what was actually responsible for accelerating these highly demanded processes. It was only until 1833 that chemists that were working in a sugar factory in France first isolated and purified the enzyme diastase from its ancillary cellular components. This was the first record of an enzyme cell-free extract being yielded. However, from here, it took a further 60 years for the German chemist Eduard Buchner to show that enzyme catalysis could be harnessed ex vivo or without the presence of a living microbe. Subsequently, thousands of novel enzymes would be discovered for a multitude of different chemical transformations, allowing biocatalysis to reach mainstream status around 20 years ago. And since that time, it has continued to become more and more widespread across industries, including food and beverage, cosmetics, waste treatment, and of course, pharmaceutical development and manufacturing. So, what scientific advances have paved the way for commonplace implementation of biocatalysis in manufacturing? Well, firstly, next generation methods in DNA sequencing have revolutionized genomic research. With ultra-high throughput capabilities, genetic material can now be deciphered rapidly compared to the conventional or old Sanger methods of DNA sequencing. This has created tremendous amounts of data which can be harnessed by researchers in vast open access databases such as Tremble. Secondly, through directed evolution and protein engineering, scientists have developed methods to tailor and optimize enzymes to suit the needs of a particular reaction via the manipulation of their DNA code. It was only in 2018 that the Nobel Prize in Chemistry was awarded to the American chemical engineer Francis Arnold for her work in directed evolution. And finally, developments in enzyme immobilisation have yielded highly efficient, robust and stable heterogeneous biocatalysts. This has directly resolved some of the key issues regarding the use of enzymes at industrial scale, and we'll talk about this in more detail in slides to come. I guess from here I'd like to pass back over to Mark now, who's going to discuss some of the key advantages of biocatalysis.
Thank you, Greg. There are several key drivers for the recent growth in biocatalysis. A number of scientific breakthroughs have led to increased commercial usefulness, and we will now take a closer look at some of them. The first and most obvious advantage is efficiency. As its name suggests, a biocatalyst, by its very nature, reduces the time needed for a chemical reaction. Although acceleration rates vary from enzyme to enzyme, examples like the thermophilic carbonic anhydrase SAS-CA, which converts carbon dioxide into bicarbonate, perform reactions that are pretty much diffusion rate controlled. The next key advantage of biocatalysis is customization. Natural catalysts have a very specific purpose. Through optimization, scientists can tailor enzymes for a particular process. In this example, the HIV drug islatravir was produced by a multi-step biocatalytic cascade. Several of the enzymes involved were the products of directed evolution, and this increased the overall yield from 15 to 51%. Another example of the benefits of enzymes is in their cost effectiveness. Although many novel enzymes can be relatively expensive, under the right conditions they can be recycled, and Greg will talk more about that later. Also, due to the high chemo and regioselectivity, side reactions are limited and costly protection and deprotection steps can be avoided. And finally, biocatalysis is environmentally advantageous. Enzymes are made from renewable resources, and most enzymatic reactions are performed in aqueous systems. Sustainability is particularly relevant for the modern pharmaceutical industry right now, as it aims to shift towards greener practices. At Stirling, developing sustainable processes is a key driver in supporting our customers in achieving their environmental goals. For example, using up Earth supplies of heavy metals in chiral catalytic reactions will not always be acceptable. Now I'd like to hand it back over to Greg, who will discuss the benefits of immobilisation.
Thanks a lot, Mark. So we're going to take a look now at what enzyme immobilisation is and how exactly it has overcome some of the key challenges of using enzymes at scale. Now, before we take a look at the power of immobilisation and just what it is, it's important we discuss the key challenges of using enzymes in synthetic chemistry. Firstly, enzymes are very sensitive, and fluctuating conditions of storage or use can denature enzymes, rendering them less efficient or ineffective altogether. Secondly, there's a widespread concern, especially in the pharmaceutical industry, that enzymes may end up in end product and thus compromise its purity. This is unacceptable, and working with biocatalysts requires a partner that have specific quality controls in place to avoid this from occurring. Thirdly, despite their ability to reduce process costs, enzymes come at a relatively high upfront expense, and anything that can be utilized to offset this cost is a welcome advancement. And so this brings me to immobilization, which is the process by which an enzyme is either affixed to or encapsulated within a heterogeneous solid support. This can be done via a variety of physical or chemical means, including adsorption, covalent bonding, cross-linking, etc. And immobilization supports, or media as we often call them, are polymers or inorganic materials such as polyacrylates or silica. In the forthcoming slides, we will discuss how enzyme immobilization directly addresses all three of the key challenges facing industrial biocatalysis, as we spoke about on the previous slide. The stability of an enzyme to conditions such as temperature, pH, and organic solvent content is significantly improved through immobilization. This is because a stable microenvironment is created for the enzyme to operate in when affixed to pores within the solid support. In the example shown, an immobilized alpha chymotrypsin was shown to be 1,000 times more active in a methanol environment compared to its free enzyme counterpart. Enhancements in stability are significant, as it allows greater flexibility in the conditions for enzyme use and the substrates with which they can act upon. Next, immobilization aids in the process of enzyme separation from end products. Without immobilization, enzymes can remain within the end product and are actually quite challenging to detect through typical analytical methods like HPLC. With immobilisation, however, the enzyme is attached to an insoluble solid support, and this means that a simple filtration can completely remove any traces of enzyme from the end product. In the example shown, an immobilised lipase called Novozyme 435 was shown to produce a pure triglyceride over 15 cycles of filtration and reuse without any diminishment of enzyme activity. This suggests that little to no enzyme had been leached from the immobilisation support and actually all had been retained within the heterogeneous catalyst. Immobilisation therefore should provide full confidence that end products are of the quality standard required for pharmaceutical manufacturing. And finally, immobilisation represents a significant cost reduction, as it enables enzymes to be separated, stored, and most importantly, recycled. This is particularly appealing for the pharmaceutical industry because it represents a direct cost saving in the manufacturing process, which is very compelling when you're dealing with large quantities of what is typically a highly expensive material. The number of times a biocatalyst can be reused varies, but in one example of a process used on site here at Stirling, an immobilised lipase has been recycled and reused for more than 20 batches over several campaigns. This has essentially diminished the upfront costs of that enzyme by about 20-fold, which is really quite remarkable. I'd like to turn it back over to Mark now, who's going to discuss some of the things that differentiate our approach to biocatalysis here at Stirling.
Thank you. The content we've covered up to this point in the webinar has centred on general biocatalysis. I'd like to now focus on the approach we take at Stirling to be our customer's choice of biocatalysis partner. We believe that many of our strengths in other fields make Stirling a compelling partner for biocatalysis projects as well. First, at Stirling, we are experts in complex and hazardous chemistry. This has been proven over our 50-year track record. The care required to handle hazardous materials safely, for example with accurate temperature control, is also beneficial for handling temperature-sensitive biocatalysts. Next, we support our customers' programs from discovery through to commercialization. As skilled API developers and GMP contract manufacturers, we have been utilizing enzymes for many years now for both our API and nutraceutical customers. Thirdly, we are a partnership development and manufacturing organization, or PDMO. That means we hold ourselves to a high standard for collaboration, communication, and transparency. We bring this PDMO model to each project, and this is vital, especially when scientific complexity makes transparency even more critical. And finally, Stirling continues to be committed to innovation in pharmaceutical API development and manufacturing. To advance this commitment, we work closely with leading academic institutions and technology providers who are widely known and respected for their expertise in biocatalysis. For example, our range of partners not only assist Stirling in the initial screening and optimization of enzymes, but also in the scale-up and commercialization activities. I would like to now mention a few of our academic collaborators. Firstly, Northumbria University is world-renowned for their expertise in biocatalysis. Through Greg and the KTP program, we are working with Northumbria's Enzomics division on customization of enzymes through directed evolution, expression, and immobilization. The second key academic partnership is with the University of Leeds. We work closely with their EPSRC Centre for Doctoral Training on novel techniques of immobilization. Their expertise will play a pivotal role in allowing us to employ immobilization for the benefit of our customers' commercial manufacturing. We are confident that this network of partners, together with our proven expertise and PDMO approach, will deliver our customers best-in-class biocatalyst solutions that raise the bar for innovation and quality. Now, there are several additional advantages to partnering with Stirling on your next biocatalysis project. For example, IP ownership of your enzyme. Anyone working in the pharmaceutical space knows the importance of this one. You're investing in the development of a biocatalyst for your compound. So here at Stirling, we believe that you should own the IP. Also, we provide the potential to store and recycle enzymes. This is aligned with our commitment to sustainability and optimization process efficiencies. In addition to having access to our expertise, our customers also gain access to the academic and scientific partners we've just discussed. The science behind industry's use of biocatalysis continues to advance and evolve, so I cannot overstate the value of this particular advantage to our customers. As well as the ability to scale up enzyme development and biocatalysis reactions through the capabilities of Stirling and our partnership network, by working with Stirling on their biocatalysis projects, our customers also gain access to full cGMP manufacture of APIs and intermediates, our core skill set. I'd now like to pass you over to Greg, who's going to go through one of our Stirling case studies.
Thank you, Mark. So yes, to finish off our webinar, I'm going to talk about a current biocatalysis project that we're working on here at Stirling, wherein we're investigating a dual enzyme cascade reaction of a highly substituted benzoic ester. Utilising the augmented panel of enzymes that we have available on site, as well as our close biologic suppliers, over 50 enzymes were screened for the two-step conversion. This allowed us to identify some weak hits, which were then screened against 22 structural analogues, which were either prepared by chemists in-house or purchased from suppliers. This allowed us to undertake what we call a sort of retro structure activity relationship study, which allowed us to identify some more enzymes from the literature with activity against compounds of high structural similarity. These additional enzymes were then essentially investigated and subsequently expressed, which allowed us to identify some more hits which were highly efficacious for the two-step conversion. From the structure activity relationship study, we were also able to paint a picture of some of the key interactions our compound was having in each enzyme active site. To solidify our findings, we're currently modelling the enzymes in silico for crystal structure characterization and active site resolution, and we anticipate that the data that we generate from this will allow us to optimize the enzymes via the route of directed evolution or protein engineering should it be necessary. So, serendipitously, whilst we're investigating the conventional route to the customer compound, we acquired data that suggested an alternative biocatalytic route may be feasible. So in exploring this route, a highly efficient enzyme for the conversion of the benzoic ester was found, though the enzyme was supplied in its cell-free extract form. The free enzyme was therefore screened against 15 distinct types of immobilisation media with an array of different affixation techniques, including ionic bonding, adsorption, covalent, and so on. From these studies, significant enzyme activity has been retained upon many of the immobilisation media tested, with next steps including optimisation and recycle studies. In the future, this process may be examined for the continuous flow synthesis of the customer compound. I'd like to pass back over to Charlotte now, who's going to conclude the webinar.
Today's webinar has provided a general overview of biocatalysis, its growth in recent years, and has highlighted its key benefits. We have then discussed the advantages of enzyme immobilisation for the pharmaceutical industry. We have discussed Stirling's approach to biocatalysis and reviewed a case study to provide greater insights into Stirling's biocatalysis solutions. Thank you for joining today's webinar.